Magicy Co-Creators,
Lilou here. I'm in beautiful, amazing, sexy Malibu with Anamika. Hello, Anamika.
Hi. Lilou, hi. Kind of looks like Morocco a little bit, doesn't it?
Yes, I love that.
Beautiful oasis.
Just paradise.
Yes, it is.
Paradise on earth.
Yes.
I love this, and I love you. I love seeing you again. I know years ago I did this interview that you might have seen on the Juicy Living Tour. I think we did one in California a couple of times.
We did one at a hotel someplace and one in somebody's home. And then one in French.
Oh yes.
A little bit, yes.
And it's great to check in a little bit, and I wanted to check in with you regarding this paradigm shift, because it's I want to say she's a spiritual teacher, but you know, titles just doesn't really land exactly right these days, because it feels we're so much more than just a limiting title. And so I'm excited to speak with you about life, you know, and this paradigm shift, and how is it different than 3 years ago? What has happened? Because it's still the same topic. So have we been in that paradigm shift for 3 years now or more? Or?
Well, there's so much to talk about this, and including what the new spirituality is really about, because we're completely changing our whole notion of what is spiritual as well. Yeah. So we can talk about that because it's really rich.
But time to redefine it.
Absolutely. Everything. In fact, the essence of the whole thing is to go beyond all definition. And to go beyond all stories, all definition, into pure personal experience, where it's not any longer about beliefs. And I'm jumping around a little bit because we could get into, let me back up just a little about 2012 and that whole big hubbub about the year 2012.
But the end of the world.
Yeah, the end of the world as we've known it, right? But back then, when we met, we had a beautiful interview about the whole paradigm shift that's occurring, and it's actually accelerated, and right up through 2015, it's moving so fast now that 2015 is really, in a way, the time that people were thinking 2012 would be. And what we're moving, it's so intense right now that the light is accelerating enormously, and the people who are moving into the light are really having their defenses breaking down, the armoring is breaking down. And for some people, that's really, really a joyous process, but it also can be a very challenging process, as evidenced by people resisting that a lot, is why we're having all these mass shootings in the schools, and you know, all the trauma and tragedy that's going on is a reflection of where people are not wanting to change, or they're resisting it. So a lot of people are leaving, and other people are really having struggles and difficulty. But nevertheless, the light is accelerating so much to the point where we really get to know ourselves and live as that light, to really know we are that. And we're in that tremendous shift right now, especially through 2015. The second half of this year, 2014 through 15, is going to be an enormous acceleration beyond anything we can even imagine. In fact, a year from now, we will not even recognize ourselves at all.
How do you know that?
Just from my perceptions and observations in my ability to perceive energy and to sense what's happening.
Let's just talk a little bit about that sensibility that you have to perceive that. How does that work, and do we all have that?
Well, everybody does. And I just happen to be particularly have developed mine since I was a child. I started in that inquiry because when I was born, I had a complete remembrance of where I came from and who I was, and also was attuned to my connection with all. So I never lost that, but yet, I had to and got to go through every single stage of development of working through, you know, just what everyone does. We build up our ego, then we work it through at a certain stage, and we go through the shadow years where we face all of our all of our issues, and we face all of that. And then we come into a period of time later, more like late 40s or around 50, it can happen at different times for people, but on the average, that's where you start to finally live more the life that you really came to live. And it doesn't mean that you weren't before, but you don't have so much of the shadow years struggle anymore. But especially this whole paradigm shift is about that, because there's an opportunity right now to move into such a state of being that's completely different than we ever have imagined. And that keeps changing every day into much more lightness and freedom.
So where are you from? You said, I know where I'm from.
You know where you're from? Everywhere. I have memories of coming from everywhere, all at once. And in my experience, it's all happening simultaneously. Yeah. Like right now, if I attune to different places, then I can experience other parts of myself in different realms at the same time.
You mean Cyrus, the Pleiades, the...
Everywhere. Yeah, okay. Everywhere.
So then you receive this information, or this, you have this knowing that we are going through that right now and this is accelerating. And do you see it visually? Do you hear it? Do you feel it? Is it just a knowing?
Yeah, all of the above. Well, here's what's so interesting. We talk a lot about the sun and the central sun being in the center of our solar system, galaxy, all of that. And that people are starting to understand that the sun is a fusion reactor, which means that hydrogen molecules, when they bump into each other, create helium, which is a whole different substance. So in the process of not either or, but the process of and, when all these things come together as an and, it creates something very, very new. And the sun generates energy through the process of fusion. We are also a fusion reactor, which means inside of us, is that reaction where it's our consciousness, where elements of our being, as we're able to integrate them, they don't come together and merge. It's not a process of merging like a child with a parent, but it's a process of fusion in our consciousness, which generates so much limitless light and freedom and energy that you end up living in a completely different reality within your, you know, in this dimension, but you feel completely different. And maybe the best metaphor I've been able to think of for this, the difference, is where you're going from gravity to weightlessness. So imagine in gravity, the body gets very acclimated to be glued to the ground, right? We're glued to the earth. And gradually, let's say you're an astronaut and you go into space and you're in your space capsule. Maybe the first thing would be you start to learn to float a little bit in the capsule. Then if you get really courageous or you're on a space mission, you might
like
go.
We have a spaceship maybe above. No, we can hear the planes. Yeah, there's planes flying.
Yeah. So maybe eventually you'll be tethered into the capsule, but you'll go floating out in your suit. And then what if gradually you got the courage to let go of the tether and take off the spacesuit, and then instead of dying, you discover that you're floating in the most oxygenated environment, or maybe it's not oxygen, but it's an environment that completely is nourishing and supportive, where you're completely weightless. Your body is going to, out of, you know, knee-jerk reaction, try to reattach to gravity, but gradually you discover that there is no gravity anymore, so you can't fall. So all of the programs and stories that were part of our primitive nervous system about falling, or about the fear of the unknown, or about not liking change, or about you know, thinking we're less than, or not knowing ourselves as the light that we actually are, as the love, those programs fall away. So what if you live from no longer believing that you are less than, or you're not who you are? What if you truly know yourself as that, and there's no gravity anymore to fight against? So you can have those programs still there, yet they're part of you, but the biggest part of you that knows itself as that light has so much compassion and love that you can include all the little parts that don't yet know that, and maybe some of them never will. Some of them change and dissolve. Some of them never do. But we have so many parts of us that are always integrating, and yet all of that gets held in this lightness and spaciousness that's completely a level of freedom that's completely different than living in gravity. It's so light, and then over time you get acclimated to learning how to navigate in weightlessness. Yeah. And so what that means in consciousness is how we create, because we've talked for years about, oh, we're co-creators and all that, but most people, you know, we have that concept intellectually, but to actually have the experience of and, which means I am me and one with all that is, and in that fusion process, we create something new that is beyond our imagination. Yeah. That is not a goal I set. It's not something I imagine. It's not something I visualize. It's not something I envision. It's so far beyond all of that, mm-hmm. that takes incredible willingness to acclimate to weightlessness, where you truly get beyond the need to know from our minds, and yet we experience from so deeply inside that something new comes about that becomes the most wondrous, magnificent, delighted exploration.
Yeah. So the challenges are not any more challenges?
No, there are always challenges, but they're challenges to grow. So you get to a point where you're not stretching, then contracting, snapping back. Oh, why do I feel like, you know, like garbage today? And I'm back in the unknown. I'm back in the blah, blah, blah. Then I stretch again and I open up again. Then I'm back in the junk. You really get to a point where you're opening, and then I'm enlightening more, and then more, and then more. And that's what enlightening really is, because there isn't a process of enlightenment. We think in old spirituality, which is locking everything into names and labels and terms. And, you know, I'm redoing my website right now, and my favorite button on the website just says fun. And it's like learning through watching a little kitty play who's just full of the exploration, the wonder, the delight of just being so present without stories. Because kittens, for example, don't have stories. You know, they're not, they're just so present. They're playing and they're rolling around, and you just get to experience the delight of that because they don't have stories attached.
Yeah.
So, you know, I'm just putting fun on my website.
There is, because spirit really wants to play, it wants to what?
Well, all that is completely delighted with our presence. Like, nothing would be the same if you weren't here, for example. You are such an integral, extraordinary part of all that nothing would be the same without you.
Yeah.
Or without you, or without you, or without all of us. Nothing would be the same whatsoever.
Yeah.
And all that is just wants to co-create and play and allow for creation to recreate itself without knowing, intellectually knowing ahead, or without imagining or envisioning, because when there's a process of fusion, we don't picture ahead of time what we're trying to create.
Mm.
It occurs.
What are the elements of that fusion?
Well, in the sun, for example, there's a lot of hydrogen that comes together to create helium. But within us, it's pieces of our own, parts of our own consciousness.
Okay.
So it's this element and that element. And the more that there's fusion occurring, the more there is a state of complexity. And complexity doesn't mean simple versus complex. It's means elegance. It means creativity, meaning the more multifaceted and complex the dances, the juicier, the more delicious, the more luscious, the more full of richness, the more extraordinary. So there's an aliveness that starts to happen that's full of light and full of luminosity that's so exhilarating that you start living from that state.
Is there some like things or elements or exercises that we can do to feel that, to witness that, to really start to live this?
Yes, absolutely. The thing that's very, very unique is that, first of all, there's spirituality or God, goddess, all that is, or you, or whatever I'm looking at, is not something outside of me that I need to reference or get something from. It's the opposite, that spirituality in this day and age has moved from a patriarchal society, or originally a matriarchal. We've gone through patriarchy, you know, in a matriarchal society where we took our power from nature. And in the matriarchal societies back then, where we took our power from nature, we were also, we were deriving our status at that point by how much we could give. And then in the patriarchal societies, we were dominating. We were taking power over nature, for example, and we derived status from how much we could take, or how much we could dominate, right? How much we could make things happen. Now we're moving, and the current society or paradigm that we live in is some blend of those two. We have matriarchal elements and patriarchal. But in both of those, spirituality was, for example, in the matriarch, it was polytheistic. There were all these gods and goddesses outside, but they were outside. In the patriarchal society, there was one god, and it was still outside. So we had to beg and plead from this punishing god to get the love, or to be loved, or to avoid being punished and annihilated and struck down, and, you know, all of that. In the new, where we're going, which is we can't know where we're going because we're creating it as we go. We are map makers.
Yeah.
You know, it's occurring. But in the new spirituality, it's deeply personal. it isn't about thoughts. It's not about beliefs. Do you believe in God? No. Do you not believe? No, it's not about belief. It's about direct experience, not explanation, but direct experience that's so deep inside, like that fusion reactor, that everything that exists is part of me. So it's not inside versus outside. It's a different definition even of inside. Because when I'm connecting and experiencing, everything is part of me and yet unique. So it's the and, which is the key concept, which is you're Lilou and I'm Anamika, and there's a place that we can both reference where we are completely one and uniquely ourselves all at the same time. And it's in that's those are the hydrogen molecules or atoms. Those are that's the fusion, that you're uniquely you and I'm uniquely me. And as we experience our connectedness, something new emerges between us that's our unique dance, and that affects all of creation, and that lets creation unfold back into us as we unfold into creation. And it's this, the unfolding. You can feel it.
Yeah, you feel it. Can you feel it? Oh, yeah. Awesome. Woo! Hey, wow.
She's taken off.
I feel good. You feel good? Oh my God, this is it. This is the light pumping in. It's better than whatever. I'm hot.
Yeah, you are. On every level.
And then there's just to laugh. Right. There's nothing to say.
Exactly.
I love it.
Right.
Oh my God, I'm blushing like crazy. So hot.
So it's the experience. It's a very deeply personal fusion experience rather than any explanation.
It's a hot fusion. Oh my God, it's so warm here. I love it. Anamika is this gift. She brings you right in this place. I mean, it takes 5 minutes, sometimes 30, depending where you are. But at some point, it happens. Oh, my God. I love that about you.
Well, I love you.
Thank you.
What the heat that you're feeling is the fusion experience, because what happens is everything starts accelerating and quickening, and you're made of so much, there's so much substance and light that starts to move that your whole physiology changes. And you literally start becoming younger and younger and younger and more open. And the armoring, the defenses that where we defended ourselves, it just starts falling off and dissolving and cracking open. And you just start getting more and more liberated and light and free.
Therefore, the healing is not really, it's occurring instantaneously. It's not like this old process of going to the psy and therapist and all that.
Well, here's the thing about one other point you asked before, how do we do this? And a very, very critical piece of this is that we are all multidimensional, which means we have so many parts. Like we have a child that's alive in us right now. Our child isn't, 20, 30 years ago or 50 or 70 or whatever. Our child is right here with us right now, and she has her own feelings. Now, the biggest part is compassionate enough, wise enough, and large enough to hold all the feelings of the child, the adolescent, the ego, the negative ego. All of the parts of us are still there, and we're always discovering more of their feelings. That goes on forever. But the integrating process, which leads to greater enlightening, is that we can hold them in the largesse or the spaciousness of our heart, of our compassion, and allow for their feelings to be there too. Uh-huh. So for example, most people think that enlightenment, which is a place I get to, they think it's enlightenment, but what they're looking at is a state of perfection. They think, whereas if I get rid of these bad feelings that I have, and I cut this away, and I get rid of it, then I'll be perfect, and then I'll be okay, and then I'll feel the way I think I want to feel. Yeah. And that's just a trap.
Yeah.
Because we are a multi-dimensional sea of everything that's constantly moving and changing. And when you're not attaching a story to the feelings, like, well, I shouldn't be feeling this, or if I only didn't feel this way, then I'd get better, or I'm just so stupid for, you know, we go into punishment, we shame ourselves, we blame ourselves, we make ourselves wrong for everything. And we can even allow for those parts that are doing that, but the more that you even love them and just let them be there and do it, they just get quiet. They dissolve. And then it's like they sit in the back of the bus and we are the bigger part of us is the one who's actually guiding and illuminating the way.
By being okay with who we are, is the best that we can do, really, to be okay in every situation.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's about really deep listening to every part. Like, who's talking right now? Is that my adolescent? Is that my child having these feelings? Or is that my adolescent? Or is that my young adult? Or is that my negative ego that's trying to sabotage everything and take me down? Like, part of the journey of integrating and enlightening is that you get to know who's talking. And you get to know the difference between authentic feelings and storytelling. Because stories are when we put an interpretation or a meaning on something and we make up something. Whereas a feeling is just a feeling. Like, oh, I feel sad. We don't have to say, I feel sad because you did this to me and I did that and therefore I feel sad. And we make up a lot of stuff. But if we just stay with, I feel sad, then instantly if you let yourself actually feel that, those feelings that are authentic feelings without stories attached are very beautiful. They're all soft, including fear and anger. They're not drama. They're real feelings that actually expand and empower us. Whereas what most people do and think are feelings are that we are into a lot of drama. We act out, I'm so mad, I'm enraged, and and what that is somebody not willing to feel their powerlessness and instead saying, I'm so pissed off because really I am powerless. But if you feel powerlessness as an authentic emotion, it doesn't render you powerless. It opens you up into your authentic power because it's the little part that's powerless vis-a-vis the biggest part, or in comparison to the biggest part, which then your fusion reactor starts turning on more the more you let yourself feel what's authentically there. So one of the most important things to learn is the difference between stories and drama versus authentic emotion. Because anything that's authentic moves, and it moves through within, you know, 20 seconds. Or maybe you sob for an hour about something if there's a big loss or something, but it really moves pretty quickly. Whereas drama recycles and recycles, and it's the same old story dressed up in new clothing every time. Same pattern with yet another person or this, right? The same thing over and over. But authentic feelings, when we feel them, move and they're soft. When people first experience what fear really feels like, they're astounded because it's like a bunny rabbit. It's so soft. But we think of, oh, I'm so scared and I'm so terrified. And then we freeze up and we lock up. And that's a story that says I'm not safe. And therefore, I go into a physiological reaction that pushes against the movement of my authentic energy. And then I'm locked up and then I'm in drama and then I'm fighting with myself. And that's where we tend to live. So when you actually shift into like weightlessness, where there's movement of energy that's authentic, it's a completely different experience of reality that is not what we grew up with. It's not what I grew up with at all. Yeah. You know, I grew up having all my real feelings suppressed and then thinking feelings, but not feeling them for real.
Yeah. It's a matter of thinking that, of noticing it, of observing ourselves and then shifting?
Or? It's a matter of being willing to feel softly. So you just shifted there. Did you feel that? Mm-hmm. Instantly you went, what do I do? And you went into your head and then your body got tense. There was tension. And then I said, feel it softly. And you instantly went, oh. And then you softened. And it's that simple. It's literally a breath away. This isn't a big complicated thing. It's just knowing where to refocus. It's not like something to figure out.
Mm-hmm. That's the present moment. That's the potential for us to fully be ourselves.
Yes, and when you let yourself be in that state, you start to feel your internal fusion reactor. You feel the energy moving and shifting. And within that sea of possibility, I mean, it's limitless. limitless possibility. The unknown is not scary. It's a delight. It's an adventure. And there can be fear within that. Like little parts of us can be scared. But there's enough safety to let all those little parts be there too. So like if our little child is scared of the unknown, we just bring compassion. We go, okay, mm-hmm. I get it that that part of me is scared. And so it's always the and. It's not that part of me is scared. Therefore, I'm going to back away and run away and cut off and not feel, which is what we tend to do. It's, okay, that little part is scared, and I'm open enough to allow for her to be scared, or him, and to still keep breathing through it, to keep opening into it, to keep experiencing, to keep showing up in the moment and experiencing whatever I'm really feeling. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The intuition then can go come through. What is intuition for you?
Well, the difference between understanding or knowing intellectually and really experiencing is where all of those words come from. Intuition, knowing, vision, I mean, all the, you know, clairsentience, clairvoyance, all of our uncommon senses come from that true, authentic knowing, where it's not an intellectual, but it's a visceral experience. So we're really moving from explanation to experience. Mm-hmm.
And embodying it. Huh?
It's completely an embodied experience. Yeah. It's from so deep inside that you can't miss it. You cannot, it's a palpable feeling. You cannot miss your own energy yeah. coursing through your body. Just like before, you felt your energy. You couldn't miss that. There's no way to miss it. There's just no way. I mean, it's alive and real. It's like you can't miss what's alive. But what most of us walked around for so many years, myself included, I've had to walk, gotten to walk through every step of this, thinking I was alive, when compared to this kind of aliveness, I was so numb and so dead and so unwilling to really show up and be present. I was caught in all these stories of who I thought I had to be, who I had to present myself as, who, you know, meeting my own expectations of excellence or perfection, trying to meet other people's, trying to be, instead of being myself.
How do you take actions then from that place?
Well, this energy of this new paradigm is so alive, it's much more alive than the other, that the impulse comes from the energy to act.
Yeah. So it's very natural.
It animates our action. Uh-huh. So our action becomes effortless, and we accomplish more with less effort. Yeah. And people, if you think from the old place, it's either I have to do, or what do? Just sit around and do nothing? So that's, no, I have to get out there and adrenalize it and, you know, pump my adrenaline and do it, or I just collapse. And it's neither of those. It's that there's a state of such aliveness that you are nourished and filled with limitless energy that impresses you into action. It guides, it illuminates, it animates.
Do we have a destiny?
Destiny?
Not destiny exists? La destinée?
La destinée. Not in the way that we think about it. Okay, but what you're here for is to know yourself, is to explore and discover who you are in concert with all, and to create from there. So that, in a sense, is the destiny. You know, there are certain things that I remember, you know, ahead of coming into this particular life, designing certain things that I wanted to kind of pay attention to, certain energies that I wanted to become aware of, certain things. But it,
like soul contracts made before?
Well, yeah, but not in the way we think of it. It's much more flexible than the way we think of it. And everything is completely changeable. And yet there are some elements that, like this Anamika life, I certainly, there are some things that I would like to experience. But it's not so much things I have to do. It's the things that I've done bring me into the experience that I'm exploring. So, for example, me sitting with people and transmitting energy and assisting them to feel themselves as I'm feeling myself, and that.
That's a wonderful experience. I mean, you got to try that. I know you. Did you bring little groups together too around here? You still do that?
Haven't recently, but I will be again at some point. Groups and workshops, and doing a lot online. I'll be doing and I just finished 4 books. I want to talk to you about those too. But that have this transmission in it, but they describe examples of the new paradigm with, for example, with an animal friend, companion, or with a human being, or different interactions. And then the final book called And has all the theory of the new paradigm. I've just written it all down. Nice. So yeah, it's all just finishing up this week. Yeah. I mean, the books are done. They're being published this week.
You see, that's what's interesting. It's interesting to me that there is people like you are just... not everybody knows you. Like this is really special conversation, and this is really showing us the, like, you're known, but you could be well more known for the type of teachings that you bring out. And this, to me, it's a privilege to be here and an honor to, you know, to share that online with as many co-creators as possible all around the world. And at the same time, I'm like, but why? You know?
That's been a choice, actually, because it hasn't been my interest to be out in the world very visibly up until now. I mean, if that, you know, maybe in the next stage, I don't know. But I've been just making the maps, if you will, just exploring and discovering and, like, staying on my own cutting edge of consciousness and just discovering everything that I could and then passing it on in whatever ways. So I'm entering a new phase now where, you know, maybe I'll be sharing it in more visible ways. But up until now, that hasn't been of interest. I've just been really intensely...
preparing.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah, making the maps.
It feels, I'm sure a lot of people listening are thinking and feeling that way. Like there's all this preparation and these things we had to go through, and now this really we're feeling the energies moving, and we're more and more comfortable, I think, with going through challenges and knowing that these are there for a reason, and we gain clarity from it, and we just keep on. So there's less resistance, I think, from all of us, and there is this willingness now to be in the invisible. Like what you're describing is very much part of the whole group of people,
yes,
you know, that have been studying or preparing or maybe being even in a cave or totally out of the radar of the matrix, wanting now to do the work in the visible. Mm-hmm. Is that something that you feel too?
Yes, because at this stage, we're really coming into a much deeper connection with who we are, our real self, and our real, what we want to do, what is an expression. You know, we get to express that real self in some way that's fun and joyous and creative in very new ways. And it's the time now, because this is the 2012 to 15 period where we get to do that. You know, that's where we are now. So you're 100% right. We're right there at that spot of opening into that. And it has to be not what I have a mission. I mean, I was so relieved when I finally realized I had no mission and purpose. I just thought I did, but I let that one go. And I thought I had the one and some soulmate. And I mean, now I've got a whole new way of relating and intimacy that's so different and so deep with a lover and with friends. And, you know, it's so, so different than ever before.
That's shifting too.
All of it. Everything is shifting. First of all, my relationship with myself, the way I relate. So instead of trying to make a relationship, it's relating from this internal place that's so, so different. But that's what we're discovering and exploring and creating as we go. So a lot of people say, well, what's the new world going to look like, or what's our future? And we're actually creating it as it's happening. But some of the things that we do know is that spirituality becomes very deeply personal. It's not anything out there. It's not matriarch, patriarch. That inside of us is a dance between our own masculine and feminine, and therefore a different masculine-feminine interaction out here in the world, in our external world, so that there's a whole different harmony and balance between masculine and feminine that's so luscious and delicious and alive. And we know that it's not going to be power over something, or either giving to overgiving or receiving, but it's a beautiful dynamic interaction and exchange of energies.
I have a question regarding going through those times, because they, we could be swimming with sharks. You know, we could be swimming in this, still was in an economy or with people around, or rules or laws that just don't match vibrationally or for our... So how can we still swim there and preserve ourselves and even thrive within that, you know?
Yeah. Well, first of all, the whole system is changing very rapidly, and especially the whole economic system is really on its way out, as we know. And that's happening more and more rapidly. So there's going to be a lot. Yet the peak of this particular way of being, I don't think will really peak in all of humanity maybe till 2050, which is okay, you know, where all of humanity really gets to what we're talking about now. Yet we can live in that state of being within the system the way it is as it's falling apart and as it's birthing at the same time, because the two things are happening simultaneously. So as we stay opening within ourselves in the new space, that radiates out and impacts all of creation and is creating our new world together. And what's crumbling within us and what's crumbling out there are the same thing too. Because another thing of the how is when we see things in the world, they really are within us. For example, you know, I can look at war and I can say, well, it looks like on the surface that my life is not at war. You know, the war is over there. But in fact, when I go deeply enough into my own self, I can feel the parts that have been at war or are still at war or wanting things in a certain way. What's different now is that I have enough compassion to let them be that way so that I don't act them out. Yeah. I don't act upon it, but I can feel everything that's happening out there. It's not just out there, it's in us too. So one of the ways to help the world, which isn't separate from us, by the way, because the world is part of us completely, one of the ways to assist is to shift those energies within us, like to come to love even those parts that whose consciousness is still very primitive. You know, our reptilian brain and our fight or flight nervous system that's at war with things, to even be able to love those parts with compassion. And in so doing, I come to such a deep state of peace with myself that I then radiate peace to those around and into the world as we know it.
It's not a matter then of protecting ourselves or putting ourselves in the bubble of light every morning or...
No, because that's saying I am not the world. And the way it feels, the way I experience it is the world is within me. Mm. It's not outside of me. I'm not in the world. The world is in me and I'm in the world.
Wow.
It's both. But the world that is in me changes as I change. As I change myself, it changes also externally, and then the world right around you becomes completely different. The people show up differently, the reactions or the responses from others are different. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Beautiful. Last little element as part of this conversation, yes. Is there something that comes to mind that you would like to share? It's your calling.
Well, merci beaucoup. Okay. I would just like to say to please trust the process, that we're in a process that's so beautiful and we are all doing our parts and we really can trust that we are changing, that we're part of change, and that as we really let go into changing and allowing ourselves to change and delighting in that, it makes it so much more fun that we really can trust that all is well. Even in right in this moment, that nothing has to change for all to be well. All is well right now. And as we open into that and embrace that and embody that, that becomes so. Yeah.
How can we reach out to you?
Well, I have a website.
Yes.
Anamika.com.
Yes. That's the best way.
Yeah, that's the best way.
And you put on there the different reunions or if you do workshops or things like that.
Yeah, they're all on the... Yes, exactly.
Thank you so much.
Lilou, it's such a pleasure.
It's an international setting. My goodness. I mean, this is like we're in Egypt or Morocco.
Well, the thing about Morocco is it's such an oasis, like this house. And it's like an oasis, which is the very quality of the new paradigm. It's like being nourished daily by the oasis.
Because paradise and hell is here.
It's heaven. It's right here.
Yeah.
It's all right here.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
It's all right here. Thank you, Lilou, so much for you.
Aww.
Thank you for you. You're truly a total gem.
Thank you, Anamika. I love you. Thank you for this delicious moment.
Thank you, everybody, for participating. We've been with you deeply, and thank you so much.
Much love. Big kisses. All Juicy Co-creators, please share this video. Oh, my goodness. This feels good.
Bye.